Well, this is going to be a review on the Top Gun, which is a 7-inch barreled Smith & Wesson 22A versus the Bottom Gun, which is a stainless steel Browning Buckmark 5.5-inch barrel. First of all, these are both 22 caliber. They can be used for target, plinker, or small game hunting, your choice. It's 22 caliber long rifle. First thing we're going to point out is the grip angle. If you look at the grip angle, you will see the grip angle is almost identical on these two guns. You pick up one and point it, pick up the other and point it, you're going to be holding your wrist about the same angle. They're almost exactly the same. Very similar ergonomics on these guns. The difference is, as you can see, the Browning has the finger grips, where the Smith & Wesson has the smooth grip. There's no position for the finger grips on there. They're both a soft rubber. The Smith & Wesson 22As are available in a 5.5-inch barrel and the 7-inch barrel. The Buckmark from Browning has two barrel configurations. Most of them are the 5.5, just like the Smith & Wesson, but then they have a 7.25-inch barrel on a couple of specialty guns too. And you'll notice that the top rib here basically is for holding the sight, holding the slide on. And when you look at the Smith and Wesson, that's a full-length rail that you can attach optics to. Okay, it does have the sight on the back, but it's a full-length rail. And where you can't attach optics on this particular Buckmark, however, you can get different rails that fit the top, and those different rails will allow you to attach optics. And the only difference is the front sight on the Browning. As you can see, that's a true glow fiber optic, whereas it's just a steel sight on the front of the Smith & Wesson. Anyhow, let's go get ahead. This is strictly a desktop review and the differences between the two guns. We'll make this real quick. Okay, we'll start off with the Browning Buckmark. And we're going to say, first of all, the magazines are pretty similar. They're both 10-round magazines, 22 long rifle. They are not interchangeable. They're not exactly the same. Buckmark, let me raise the camera up just a little bit, a little easier for me. Okay, the Buckmark is, they both have the same design as far as blowback. The slide goes straight back. I'm going to go ahead and lock it open. And it's straight, they call it blowback, straight blowback. And again, this top rail guides the slide, keeps the slide from popping off and anything like that. They both have the exact same controls except for the mag release. They both have a manual safety. They both have the slide lock. And on both guns, when you fire the last round, the slide will lock open. And there's the slide release, and then the mag button right here. Now, this is a standard mag release, like most guns have. The button is right behind the trigger. And as you can see, all you got to do is take it with your thumb and pop it, and out she comes. Very easy. This is a real standard, like most guns. This Buckmark has a gold trigger. I think that's just something they put on all their guns to distinguish their guns from other guns. I wish it was gold. I think it's just aluminum anodized to a gold color. Again, very comfortable, very well balanced, easy controls. Handles good, points good, very nice balance. Okay, now we're going switch over. This again, I've got to back up a little bit because it's got a longer barrel by 1.5 inches. Again, you got the top rail on there, you got all iron sights, you got the same controls, you got the safety. You got the slide release. The difference is the mag. There is no button on this one. If you see on there, there is no button for the mag. Where is the release? The release is actually in the front of the grip, which is very unusual. Takes a little getting used to it, but it works real well. I have no problem with using it. So let's say we fired it and it's locked back, and I need to get a new mag on there. Okay, so we've got it open, locked back. I found that I can keep my grip on there very easily. All I got to do is move that one finger and pop it. Okay, and there's no way of accidentally releasing it because it is recessed. It is recessed in the bottom there a little bit. So you can't, no matter how you grip it, you're not going to release it. But when you want to release it, you get used to it. It's actually pretty convenient. Anyhow, there's the differences. The two guns are very similar. This gun, the takedown is there. You push this with a slide lock back. You push this button in really hard. It's very difficult to push it in. Then the barrel will tilt off. Then the slide comes off. And the takedown on the buck mark is you have to actually remove these two top screws, and then you can get the slide off, and then the barrel comes off. There's just a screw in the front. You loosen that up, and the barrel comes off. So you can take these guns down completely, very easily. You know, don't need a lot of tools. Just on the Smith & Wesson, you don't need any tools. On the buck mark, you need a couple of Allen wrenches, and that's it. Very easy to work, okay? They're both balanced real well. As I say, this gun, being that it's a 7-inch gun, the Smith & Wesson, it's a little heavier towards the tip, which it should be. And we're going to get into the weight of the two. Very simple. I'm going to just pan up here a little bit more. Got a real accurate scale there. Okay, we're going to put the... neither one of these have safeties. Neither one of these have magazines on them, okay? This is a 32-ounce scale, very accurate. That's coming in at 37 ounces, just a shade under 37 ounces. That's the Smith & Wesson, just a shade under 37 ounces, okay? And then we go ahead and put the buck mark on here, and the buck mark, again, no magazine in there, and that comes in about 31 ounces, maybe a shade over 31 ounces, just about 31 ounces. So we're dealing with 37 versus 31, so 6 ounce difference between the two guns as far as weight wise, not very much. Okay, we're going to do the trigger now. And one thing I will tell you before we get to the trigger is both of these guns come with a magazine safety. And what a magazine safety is, the gun will not fire unless there's a magazine installed. Okay, so I have this one racked back. I don't have a magazine in there, so that means this gun should not fire. However, if there had been a round in there, it would have fired. Both of these guns, I have removed the magazine safety. I don't care for a magazine safety. I use proper gun safety. I make sure when I'm done with the gun, I lock the slide open, make sure there's no rounds in the chamber. There's never, ever going to be left a live round in the chamber when I'm not using this gun. That's individual thing. Some people say, oh, I like a magazine safety. I would never have a magazine safety on a self-defense gun. I want that gun to fire whether there's a magazine in it or not. This is not really a self-defense gun, but anyhow, the magazine safety has been removed on the Browning buck mark, and the magazine safety has also been removed on the Smith & Wesson. Now, you shouldn't fire a lot of dry fires. The buck mark, you can dry fire all you want. It will never hit the chamber. However, on the Smith & Wesson, it will. But I just wanted to show you that it does fire without a magazine in there. Okay? Now we're going to go ahead, and I have a little vise right there. And that's a little vise with a little clamp on the bottom of it. And it fits into my desk. I'm going to back up here a little bit so you can see what I'm doing here. And I just clamped this thing down on my vise here. And I got a piece of wood in there that fits in the empty magazine well. Matter of fact, I wouldn't be able to do these tests holding this thing solid like that if I hadn't already removed the magazine safety, because I would have had to have a magazine in there to get it to work. Okay, I got to tilt this down a little bit more. So there's slightly different in the magazine angle. There's just a slight difference between the two. I want to get this one straight. So when we measure it, the trigger pull weight, cock it. Okay, it is cocked. And what I use is I use a Lyman trigger gauge. That's a Lyman digital trigger gauge. We can go ahead and get it turned on there. And on the end of the Lyman trigger gauge, you can see there's a little roller. And what that roller does is that roller fits in the on the trigger, and then you pull back. I'll get back just a little bit further. You can see what basically you do. You just line everything up, and then you pull straight back, and you get your correct trigger reading. So that's what we're going to do. I'm going to get centered up here, get everything, get this camera lined up here so it's straight, pretty well level, so we can read it. And that looks pretty close right there. All I got to do is get it to focus on there. Okay, it should be focusing. Yep, now we're nice and clear. Okay, I've got it cocked. Let me make sure it is cocked. I've been finding this comes out about 4, 7, 8, 9. I mean, they're going to vary a little bit. When you're dealing with it, let me pull back just a little bit here. When you're dealing with trigger pull weights, you just vary it a little bit on where you mount it on the actual trigger, and it is going to make a difference in the trigger pull, a few ounces one way or another. So all of that has a varying. I try to do it always the same way, but there's always going to be some variation. Okay, I'm pulling back gently. We're at 3 pounds there. I try to pull very slow when I think we're going to get close to the break point. That's 4, 4. That was almost 4:13, which is a little more than usual. And again, as I said, it just depends how I line this thing up. Usually I figure it's around 4:09 or 4:10. It's a Browning buck mark. We'll do it one more time. And I pulled a little too fast. If you pull fast, you don't get an accurate reading. I apologize for that. Try one more time. Not so fast. To get up to 4, I got to go nice and slow. Where it was 10. So we got 2 pulls at about 4 pounds, 10 ounces on the Browning buck mark. Now we're going to go ahead and put the Smith & Wesson 22A1 in there. Get it cocked. This one has, I've been finding this is about 4 pounds, 2 ounces. Pretty consistent. Okay, pull slow from here on out. Four pounds, 1.7. You see that? Pretty close to 4 pounds, 2 ounces. Pulling slow. I pulled too fast. Again, If you pull fast, you don't get an accurate reading. You got to pull slow and steady. Try it again. Now I'm getting a little bit less there. I don't know why I'm getting so much less of a pull there. I might have been pulling a little bit downwards. That's 3 pounds, 13 ounces. So the pull on this one is coming in just under 4 pounds. The other one was 4 pounds, 8 ounces. So we had about an 8 ounce, approximately an 8 to 10 ounce difference in pull. And now I'm going to show you the difference in trigger pull length. And we'll be all set here. We'll get in here with a nice close view, get it as clear as I can. Okay, that's pretty clear right there. Okay, we're going to show you the dimensions on the trigger pull. Make sure it's cocked. Yeah, it has to be cocked or you ain't going to get it. There's free play right there. I'm going to put this little measure up there to the bottom of the bottom front of the trigger. That's what I'm going after. Okay. And you can see that's it's over 3/32. It's less than an eighth. That's take up or free play. This gun has a lot more free play, but then once you get the free play out of there, I'm going to move back to where I have no free play. It has a much shorter trigger pull. Pull this as steady as I can right there. I'm picking up the sear, and you'll see it pulls to about a 16th of an inch, and it breaks to about a 16th of an inch. I don't know what I did there. I did something wrong there. Something moved, because that's not the correct at all. That isn't even close to being correct. Okay, we know what we've got. 3/32 to just a little under an eighth of an inch. I'm going to hold that steady right there. I'm pulling on the sear, the bottom of the trigger right there. I must have moved the measure. That's right about a 16th right there. And it pulled to about, so it broke a little over a 16th, and it had a little over a 16th of over travel. Now we're going to go ahead and do the buck mark. Buck mark has a lot less Free play, which is not a bit, I don't mind free play. Free, it's once I get to there, that's where I want to know where my trigger is right there. And you can see there's very little. There's the free play on there. That's less than a 32nd of an inch, at the most a 32nd of an inch. Okay, so we're going to go back to where there's, and they talk about they have good triggers on these things. Okay, so here we go. That's just about a 32nd. And see, they both have the same overall length of pull, which is about 5/32 of an inch. It's just a shade over an eighth of an inch. However, this one has a shorter actual pull till the break point. Okay, so it's got a much shorter sear pull. Let's see if I can hold that nice and tight. There we go, right there. Hold it still. Yeah, that was too fast. Too fast, didn't show up. Really hard to pull these things slow and right there, the bottom of the five, right on the five. Pulling as slow as I can. There it is, right there. So it broke at about a 32nd inch, had 3/32, a little over 3/32. That's it between the two guns. They're both very nice guns. I will tell you price-wise, the Buckmark is much more expensive. Of course, you got the name Browning on them. I don't know why this thing is not focusing for me. It should be focusing. There it comes. You've got the name Browning, and of course, Browning is associated with more expensive guns. The Buckmark, generally, you're dealing with a little over $400 for their low-end guns, and you can spend easily over $600 for their guns. The Smith and Wesson, honestly, it's $339 list price. Now, that's what I was talking. List price is a little over four. I think 419 is their low price gun. They go over to $600. This gun here is, I think, is 439. I mean, 339 list price. So it's considerably less expensive. And it's a well-made gun. I don't see a problem with either one of them. Haven't had them out shooting them, but I expect them both to be perform pretty similarly. The only difference is with that being a little longer barrel, that gun should be a little bit more accurate. Anyhow, I purchased both these guns off GunBroker just before, maybe a week apart, just before Christmas of 2013. I actually got this gun for $250, including shipping, which is really cheap. Shipped it to my local FFL. It was $250. And this gun cost me $320, including shipping, to my FFL. Now, I paid, it was an auction bid, and there was a charge for shipping. I think I won this gun for $295, and there was $25 shipping charge. And I got this gun for, I think it was $230 with a $20 shipping charge. So it was $250 for this one, my net price. And this one cost me 250, 315. Great values. There are some really good deals on GunBroker. You just got to be choosy, determine how much you're willing to pay, and hope you get lucky and you're the high bidder and you don't get somebody that wants to bid crazy and bid the prices up real high. Anyhow, that's it for now. I'm going to be doing some more things. I want to get both of the trigger pulls down to around 2.5 pounds. So I will probably make some more videos showing you how I accomplished that. But for a target range gun, 2.5 pound trigger pull should be just about perfect. At least that's what I want, for my opinion. Thank you.